Welcome to the service for churches in the York Circuit. The theme for the Sunday before Lent is Jesus' Transfiguration. So we pray that we too will experience glimpses of his glory in our worship and in our daily lives. So we begin with God's invitation to be still and know that he is God.
For the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Come bow before him now with reverence and fear. In him no sin is found. We stand on holy ground. Be still, for the presence of the Lord, the Holy One, is here. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. Burns with holy fire, with splendor he is crowned. How awesome is the sight, our radiant King of light. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. For the power of the Lord is moving in this place. He comes to cleanse and heal, to minister his grace. No work too hard for him. In faith, receive from him. Is moving in this place. Is moving in this place. Be still.
Heavenly Father, you are wonderful beyond our imagining and constantly reach out to us in love. We ask forgiveness for when we have forgotten that you are God, for when we have not listened to your voice, for when we have trusted in our own strength rather than in yours. Restore us by your Spirit and challenge us through your word, that we may be worthy disciples of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
The reading is taken from the second book of Kings, chapter 2, verses 1 to 12, in the Good News translation. Elijah is taken up to heaven. The time came for the Lord to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elijah and Elisha set out from Gilgal, and on the way, Elijah said to Elisha, "Now, stay here. The Lord has ordered me to go to Bethel." But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord and to you that I will not leave you." So they went on to Bethel. A group of prophets who lived there went to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master away from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha answered, "but let's not talk about it." Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Now stay here. The Lord has ordered me to go to Jericho." But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord and to you that I will not leave you." So they went on to Jericho. A group of prophets who lived there went to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master away from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha answered, "but let's not talk about it." Then Elijah said to Elisha, "Now stay here. The Lord has ordered me to go to the Jordan River." But Elisha answered, "I swear by my loyalty to the living Lord and to you that I will not leave you." So they went on, and 50 of the prophets followed them to the Jordan. Elijah and Elisha stopped by the river, and the 50 prophets stood a short distance away. Then Elijah took off his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided, and he and Elisha crossed to the other side on dry ground. There Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what do you want me to do for you before I am taken away? Let me receive the share of your power that will make me your successor," Elisha answered. "That's a difficult request to grant," Elijah replied, "but you will receive it if you see me as I'm being taken away from you. If you don't see me, you won't receive it." They kept talking as they walked on. Then suddenly a chariot of fire pulled by horses of fire came between them, and Elijah was taken up to heaven by a whirlwind. Elisha saw it and cried out to Elijah, my father, mighty defender of Israel, you are gone." And he never saw Elijah again. This is the word of the Lord.
Speak, O Lord, as we come to you to receive the food of your holy word. Take your truth, plant it deep in us, shape and fashion us in your likeness, that the light of Christ might be seen today in our acts of love and our deeds of faith. Speak, O Lord, and fulfill in us all your purposes for your glory. Test our thoughts and our
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark chapter 9 verses 2 to 9. The Transfiguration. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter, James and John and led them up a high mountain where they were alone. As they looked on, a change came over Jesus and his clothes became shining white, whiter than anyone in the world could wash them. Then the three disciples saw Elijah and Moses talking with Jesus. Peter spoke up and said to Jesus, "Teacher, how good it is that we are here. We will make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He and the others were so frightened that he did not know what to say. Then a cloud appeared and covered them with its shadow, and a voice came from the cloud. "This is my own dear son, listen to him." They took a quick look around, but did not see anyone else, only Jesus was with them. As they came down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Don't tell anyone what you have seen until the Son of Man has risen from death." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Now, I'm not a great one for having mystical experiences. I can feel almost in another world when I experience the wonders of the natural world or the depth of a special relationship. But those feelings are rooted in the earthly reality of the world around me. I have also experienced those lightbulb moments when a disjointed jigsaw of experience suddenly falls into place and the bigger picture becomes clear. I don't know into what precise category I would put the story of the Transfiguration told in our reading from Mark's Gospel. But in any case, for me, it is filled with important meaning. I assume it was also for Peter, James and John, as it must have been their telling of the story that ended up in our written Gospels. Mark tells us that Jesus and the three disciples went up a mountain. Going up the mountain sets the scene for a divine encounter, as does the experience of dazzling light and the cloud which comes over them later. Going up a mountain, cloud descending and their dazzling light are regular symbols for the presence of God in the Bible. And that's the context in which the disciples see Jesus meeting and talking with Moses and Elijah. Traditionally, Moses and Elijah were key figures in representing the law and the prophets, the content of the Hebrew scriptures and the basis of Jewish faith. And here, Jesus is conversing with them. I'm not sure it had dawned on me before how important is the phrase, "they were talking with him." This was not just an appearance or a message. It was a conversation, a mutual experience. It was a living experience of what Jesus was indicating when he said, "Do not think I came to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill." Here Jesus is seen in mutual conversation, in a living relationship. He was not looking up the law in historical records, not delving into past prophecies, not recording prophetic words. He was seen entering into the essence of his faith through personal relationships. And this is emphasized by the record of the divine voice. "This is my son, listen to him." And there's an echo here of the old story of Elijah passing from this earth and handing the prophetic baton on to Elisha. Significantly, Elisha asks for a double portion of Elijah's spirit. Not a copy of his words or deeds, not an instruction book, not a how to be a prophet guide, but an ongoing developing experience of his life. The Transfiguration story confirms Jesus' role as the Word made flesh. At one with what has gone before in God's relationship with God's people, but also in a living and therefore developing contemporary relationship. That living and developing relationship continued in the growth of the church as it moved from being a small but significant Jewish sect to a movement influencing all people everywhere. In this development, we hear of the tension between those who believed remaining faithful to the past required continuing adherence to the Jewish law, and those who believe that while remaining true to the faith of history, they were called to develop a new life in Christ, which meant leaving some of the old ways behind. Paul's argument that the Gentiles should not be required to keep all the details of Jewish regulations was a key step in this development and illustrates the tension of the time. This tension between holding to the ways we have previously expressed our faith and belief and allowing that tradition to provide roots for ongoing growth in God's Spirit is still with us. We've always done it this way. It's worked before, so why change? These can be recurring comments that are expressed. And it's not only in the church that this happens. There are other aspects of human life where we have difficulty in moving away from principles which no longer hold the same meaning that they once did. We're living through a time of major crisis. While it's the coronavirus pandemic that seems to be taking up the major news time at the moment, it can be argued that it is the climate crisis that has more far-reaching consequences, with its threat of mass extinctions and depletion of the Earth's resources. In both these cases, there is extra tension because nations seem to be tied to that old economic tool that demands financial growth as essential. We seem to keep measuring an individual's success by how much money they make and a nation's success by the size of its gross domestic product. So in the COVID crisis, decisions are made not just on health grounds, but on estimates of likely damage to economic, that is, monetary, growth. Likewise, although we know that burning fossil fuels is a major contributor to climate change, the authorities still find economic grounds to approve the opening of a new coal mine in Cumbria. Thankfully, there is some good news. The development of vaccines is likely to be a significant tool in controlling the coronavirus. And there are new economic tools that are being produced that will help us to measure the well-being of humanity by other means than by simple financial growth. There's a new government report that talks of the need to value land by its environmental contribution and ability to support biodiversity rather than how much money it's capable of making. And contemporary economic specialists are producing new tools that value social well-being, health and environmental contributions as highly as financial growth, actually setting limits on those things which damage the potential of our world. One example of this is the intriguingly called donut model of economics, proposed by Kate Raworth, a senior academic at Oxford University. This sets both an ecological ceiling, no endless growth, beyond which lie further climate change and destruction of the Earth's resources, and a social foundation, which ensures the basic needs of people are met. Can we let go of the yearning for growth as measured in financial terms, and commit to a growth of the well-being of all who inhabit the Earth? Significantly, the theme of the Methodist Prayer Handbook this year is "The Earth is the Lord's." And I think it's important to add the next phrase of Psalm 24, "and all that is in it." We have a God-given responsibility to care for the earth, And just as Jesus was seen talking with Moses and Elijah, so we need to develop our relationship with Christ and our growth in his Spirit, and ensure we can be faithful to God's way. We need to develop ways of expressing our faith and belief that fit the needs of God's world for today and tomorrow. May God's Spirit help us to do so. Amen.
Pray together. Creating God, we thank you for all the glimpses of your glory that inspire us in our relationship with you. We thank you for the wonders of nature, the love of family and friends, the privileges of prayer and worship, the challenge and comfort of your word. We thank you that it is your nature to meet with us, and we rejoice in our fellowship with you and with one another in Christ. Help us to treasure and nurture that relationship. We thank you that you go on reaching out to us, even when we attempted to turn away. And we pray for those who find it hard to see your glory at this present time, because they're bereaved, lonely, worried, or in pain. And we pause to remember those particularly on our minds. Help us, Lord, to be the human face of your love for them, so that they will know they are not forgotten. We pray for all the downtrodden of the world, that they will be given hope and relief. And we pray for a just and wise use of the earth's resources, and for grace to play our part in protecting the planet and its life. Today's collect. God of life and light, your Son was revealed in majesty before he suffered death on the cross. Give us grace to perceive his glory, that we may be strengthened to follow him and be changed into his likeness from glory to glory, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and for ever. Amen. The love of God transform us, that we may bring forth the fruit of his kingdom. And may the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon us, upon those dear to us, upon his church and his world, this day and always. Amen.